Good morning, everybody. I'd like to thank Dr. Abhishek Kothari for this opportunity and AIOS also. Embolic CRO was first described by von Graffe in 1859, and in that case, it was a case of infective endocarditis. It's a very rare disease, seen in 1 per 10,000 outpatient visits, and in general population, it's even rarer, 8.5 per 100,000. It affects patients from 5th to 6th decade, more common in males, and in 1 to 2%, it may be bilateral. Arterial occlusions can manifest as CRAO, central retinal artery occlusions, Barnes retinal artery occlusions, ciliaretinal artery occlusions, and combined occlusions where the retinal artery and the retinal vein both are involved. Among cases of acute artery occlusion, the incidence is most common of CRAO, which is 57%, followed by BRAO, and ciliaretinal artery occlusions are relatively uncommon. CRAO is more common in men in the older age group, and it presents as painless vision loss over several seconds. There's a history of amaurosis fugax in 10%, and vision may be counting fingers to PL in 90% of patients. RAPD is very commonly seen, and if you just do anterior segment exam, it will be absolutely normal in acute cases. The real findings we'll see in the posterior segment, and within the first few minutes to hours, it may still look quite normal. But over the next few hours, you have a pale and gray retina with a cherry red spot, which is characteristic. And you can see the cherry red spot involving the fovea here. And for a surrounding area, you can see the whitening. Also, you can see the thin attenuated vessels, which we also call box scarring. It's because of the segmentation of the blood flow in these patients. In the chronic stage, over 4 to 6 weeks, you have a pale optic disc, thin attenuated vessels, resolved whitening, and fine changes in the RPE. This is another patient where you can again see the cherry red spot surrounded by the whitening of the retina at the posterior pole. Emboli may be visible in retinal artery system in 20 to 40%. The most common are the cholesterol emboli, which are seen in 70%, also known as Hollenhaus plaques, followed by platelet fibrin emboli and calcific emboli. 25% of patients may still retain good vision because they have a patent ciliaretinal artery. So you can see in this picture that above and below there's a whitening, but the area, the territory of the ciliaretinal artery is spared in this case. Rubiosis may occur in more than 20%, and you must remember that rubiosis can occur very early in CRAO, and here it occurs in 4 to 5 weeks, whereas in CRVO, we normally see it after three to five months. And more common in severe and prolonged occlusion. Systemic associations are very, very important because 90% of affected patients have evidence of systemic disease. Associated diseases include hypertension, which is number one, followed by diabetes, ischemic heart disease, CVA, blood dyscrasias, coagulopathies, leukemia, lymphoma. And in case of bilateral occlusion, when both eyes are affected, we must look out for cardiac valvular diseases, GCA, which is very important because giant cell arteritis is an emergency, and other vascular, like rare disease like Susak's disease. The retinal emboli of cardiac origin, the RECO study, which was a multicentral trial which observed the cardiac findings associated with acute retinal artery occlusion, it found structural cardiac pathology in 50% of patients, and carotid atherosclerosis was seen in 45% of patients. BRAO is less common compared to CRAO. It's seen more in men in the older age group. In these cases also, there's abrupt unilateral painless vision loss with a partial field loss. So the patient will give a characteristic of a partial, almost like altitudinal defect. On exam, there'll be intact central visual acuity in 50% of patients. There may or may not be a RAPD, and anterior segment will be normal. So here you can see the localized area of superficial whitening. And this is the localized area along the distribution of the vessel which has got occluded. And you may see the presence of a retinal emboli. So more than 90% we should look for in the temporal area because this is the vessel which is normally affected. The visual prognosis is good unless the fovea is involved. 80% of eyes may improve to 20 by 40 or better, although the residual field defect usually remains and doesn't go away. So these are some more examples of BRAO involving the inferotemporal vessels. Third variant is the ciliated artery occlusion, because this is an artery which enters the retina from the temporal side of the optic disc. It's seen clinically in 20%, but if we do angiography, we can pick it up in 32% of patients. It derives from the posterior ciliary artery circulation, and if there's an occlusion of this vessel, it will look something like this. The whitening will be in the center, and the areas above and below will give an appearance of a normal retina. There may be three clinical variants of the ciliaretinal artery occlusion. It may be isolated, where only the ciliaretinal artery is involved. It may be a ciliaretinal artery occlusion associated with CRVO, or central retinal venous occlusion, or it may be associated with AION. The isolated form has the best prognosis, 90% improved to 20, 40 or better vision. If it's associated CRVO, it is constitutes 40% of the patients. Venous obstructions are non-ischemic, and maybe 70% would achieve 20/40 or better. The occlusions when associated with AION carry the worst prognosis, and we must always rule out a possibility of giant cell arteritis in these patients. Move on to combined arterial and venous occlusions. In these patients, the visual acuity is very poor, sometimes maybe even no light perception, but generally it is PL activity. There's opacification with, it's a combined form, so you have a cherry red spot also. The posterior pole will show whitening, but you'll also have signs of venous obstruction like dilated tortuous vessels, retinal hemorrhages, swollen disc, and thickening. It may be associated with other diseases like collagen vascular diseases, leukemia, orbital trauma, retrobulbar injections, or mucormycosis, and risk of NVI is extremely high, of 75%, so we need to look out for this complication. There may be three types of the combined occlusions. We may have a CRVO with a CRAO. We can have a CRVO with a central branch retinal artery BRAO, or you may have CRVO with a ciliaretinal artery occlusion. This is a wide field photograph of a patient with CRAO and CRVO. If we look up, there's whitening at the posterior pole, which gives us an idea of the CRAO. And what is very important in the wide field, you see the amount of capillary non-perfusion. So there's a cutoff area and there's a vast area of, so this is a patient who's very, very likely to go into neovascularization and needs a tight PRP, coagulation of the retina to prevent neovascular glaucoma in the future. Investigations, of course, like I already discussed, the fluorescein angiography is important. This shows the delay in the AV transit time, non-filling or delay of the involved vessels, staining of sclerotic vessels, box scarring or segmentation of the vascular blood column. And this is the typical picture with the box scarring of the vessels. ERG, because the inner retina is affected, the B wave will be diminished and you'll get a negative waveform. A reduced or absent A and B wave should lead one to suspect an ophthalmic artery occlusion rather than just a CRAO. The workup will be discussed in detail by Dr. Schommerstedt in the next talk. So I'd just like to short word that this should always be done in conjunction with the physician or internist. Complete blood counts, ESR and C-reactive protein are very important because we want to rule out giant cell arteritis. Blood sugar, blood culture, ANA. And of course, the coagulation test study is also important to rule out coagulopathies. Imaging studies also should be done with the internist in mind and in consultation with him. Carotid, the Doppler should be done, echo, and if required, a MRA also. Come to the treatment. It is a recent CRAO is an emergency. Now the question is, how recent is recent? So experimentally, Dr. Harry and his group have shown in the rhesus monkey that in primate retina, that 240 minutes, 4 hours leads to complete irreversible death of the retina. But we, of course, try to do something for the patient, a conservative approach with aggressive treatment up to 24 hours. This is the cutoff we normally follow. And the aim is, of course, to increase retinal blood flow and oxygenation, reverse the arterial obstruction, and further prevent further damage to the patient's retina. Ocular massage is a simple thing all of us can do. Apply direct pressure for 10 to 15 seconds, release for 5 seconds. You can do it digitally, or you can press on the eye with a fundus contact lens. And it is said this can dislodge an embolus to a point further down the arterial circulation and thereby improve the retinal perfusion. You may give acetazolamide, beta blockers, or do an AC paracentesis in order to decrease the intraocular pressure. And other things which people have tried in the past include carbogen, which is a mixture of 5% carbon dioxide, 95% oxygen. and also hyperbaric oxygen therapy, which is said to help in certain patients. Associated with temporal arteritis, like discussed before, it is an emergency because it can affect the other eye. You can have a bilaterally blind patient, so we have to take it very seriously. And IV methylprednisolone must be started immediately. The very controversial topic about intra-arterial fibrinolysis, it is because there was limited evidence to prove its efficacy, but there was a high amount of systemic complications like TIA, cerebral hemorrhage, and hematoma. There was a study which was done in Europe called the Eagle study, and they studied intra-arterial fibrinolysis, and they found it didn't give any benefit, and the risk was so high. It was published in 2010 in Ophthalmology, and they had to stop the study midway because it did not show much benefit. Other things people have tried, which doesn't have much hope, are systemic and retropapaverine or tolazoline, sublingual nitroglycerin, and even direct laser to the area of the embolus. The new kid on the block is vitrectomy. So this article published in Retina, where they showed vitrectomy as a treatment for central retinal artery occlusion. And Dr. Nishikant Bose, one of our colleagues from Bombay, has shown a very beautiful video in the past in which he has done vitrectomy and removed certain, like a fibrous membrane of the over the optic nerve head, and helped to dislodge, and you can see the vessel reperfusing. So that is something very interesting, and we look forward to more data on that. And this is one of the promising things in the future for CRAO. So most important thing is that patients must understand that prognosis recovery is very poor, and that the visual changes are a result of a systemic process which needs proper evaluation and treatment. Thank you.